before. Good evening and welcome to tonight's meeting of Inforum, dubbed the Hip Young Division of the Commonwealth Club, with a mission to inspire debate on civic issues. You can find us online at commonwealthclub.org/inforum. I'm Rachael King, writer at Bloomberg Businessweek. Joining me tonight is Timothy Ferriss. He is the author of number one New York Times bestseller, The 4-Hour Workweek, and recently published and chart-rising 4-Hour Body. In 2007, he was named one of Fast Company's most innovative business people. And in 2008, he won the prize for Wired Magazine's greatest self-promoter of all time. And he is the world's record holder for most consecutive tango spins. Now it's our chance to talk to the icon himself. Let's get started. Welcome, Tim.
Thank you for having me.
So, Tim, both of your books, The 4-Hour Workweek and The 4-Hour Body, center around something you call lifestyle design. What is exactly lifestyle design?
So lifestyle design was a term that I struggled to produce in mid-2005. I was in Argentina at the time, and the entire trip that led me to Argentina had been sparked by an ex-girlfriend. This was in June of 2004, Katie, who...
No bitter feelings.
I actually owe her a huge debt of gratitude. She broke up with me. It was probably the closest I've come to getting engaged. And she broke up with me because of my work schedule. I was working from 7 a.m. to 9 p.m., chasing the time zones and customers and distributors and so forth in different time zones. And she put a lot of effort into her Dear John letter, which wasn't a letter. It was actually one of those photograph holders that fold out that you see at Target. They're wire brushed. And she really put some thought into it. So there was first a collage. I'm not kidding. I still have this. With a profile photograph of my head cut out, put onto a paper body of someone in a business suit running with papers flying out of a briefcase. And then in the middle it said, business hours end at 5 p.m. with 3 exclamation points. And she gave it to me and said, I think you should put this on your desk for your personal health. And that was a catalytic moment for me that really underscored the fact that income had no value without time. And I was doing very well. I was, at the time, financially earning more per month than I had been earning per year when I first worked in the startup in San Jose. So flash forward about a year, I'm in Argentina. I've been following any degree of spontaneity from country to country after automating my own business. Mm-hmm. And I had been teaching a class called High Tech Entrepreneurship at Princeton twice a year. And I gave a lecture that was intended to be about how to create a highly profitable startup without outside funding. And I realized that that is, for most people, just a means to an end. So I wanted to talk about how to quantify what your ideal lifestyle is composed of, whether that's having certain possessions, having certain experiences, and then work backwards from that to design a business model around that, whether that's a career or a startup. And that is, in a very, very long-winded way, what lifestyle design is.
Great. And you think other people can have that, can think about, you know, what their intention is for their lives?
I think so. And I don't think it needs to be nebulous or new agey. I think it can be very specific. And you end up determining a number which is called target monthly income, which would allow you to have the things that you currently defer for retirement. And what you find when you quantify the finances required to, let's say, hypothetically, have an Aston Martin DB9, have a ski chalet for part of the year in Aspen, et cetera, it very rarely takes more than $75,000 a year. And the deferred life plan, in other words, postponing these things you want to do, the true passions that you have for A, B, and C, until retirement is a very dangerous gambit. And I'm sure everyone in this room, or many people in this room, have had close ones die or end life prematurely. I've had 3 friends diagnosed with cancer this year alone. Wow. One of my friend's daughters just died, 12 years old, from cancer. And I think it is very haphazard to postpone what it is that you want to do for a retirement that's 20, 30 years in the future. So the objective with the 4-Hour Workweek was to share the case studies that I found of people who were also, although they didn't label it lifestyle design, looking at how they could actualize the things they wanted to experience now as opposed to later. And that doesn't mean being short-sighted. It just means being very realistic about what you can control and what you can't. And unfortunately, death is one of those things that you do not have complete control over.
No, you don't.
Not to be morbid about it.
So as you said, you went from working 14-hour days and earning $40,000 per year to working four-hour weeks and earning $40,000 plus per month. Mm-hmm. I think we'd all maybe like to do that. Mm-hmm. Was there a certain time when you realized, you said you realized this had to change when Katie, but how did you get from realizing that was going to change, you needed to change that, to actually making it happen?
I started reading more philosophy, and in particular, this is more recently that I've really delved into it, but Stoicism and Seneca. It's not the most recent stuff, but it's very, very relevant. If you did a search replace of letters from a Stoic and just put in like Robert and John, it would seem just as relevant today as it was 2,000 years ago. But I telescoped. What I mean by that is I said, given my current activities, given my current program, my way of being and acting, if I project this forward 5 years, what does my life look like? If I project this forward 10 years, what does my life look like? And none of those pictures were terribly pretty. And the problems would get much, much worse as opposed to getting better by themselves. So I set a, I remember I was at a friend's, my friend Doug's apartment in Brooklyn. This was after Katie had given me her very thoughtful gift, and decided that I would buy a one-way ticket to London to remove myself from my schedule, my routine, and within 4 weeks I would either automate all the decision making in my company that was consuming my time, remove myself as a bottleneck, or I would shut down the company, despite the tremendous income that it was providing at the time, which was substantial. And it worked. It was very hard, very, very hard. I remember the first day I woke up in London, I was staying at a former classmate's house, and he had left to work, so I woke up at 10 a.m., and I had envisioned, you know, waking up like a cat on a windowsill, like stretching, and this freedom, great, I can do whatever I want. Instead, woke up, scanned the room, looking for my laptop to check my email, realized I didn't bring my laptop, because it'd be like giving a dime bag to a hairnet, and proceeded to have a complete nervous breakdown and just wander around the city, not knowing what to do with myself, feeling vaguely guilty the whole time. Because the first rule I had set was I could only check email once a week. And I could do it for 2 hours. And keep in mind, this is going from, you know, send, receive, send, receive, send, receive, like a rat with a cocaine pellet dispenser, to once a week. Because I recognize that if I'm constantly in this reactive mode where I feel like I'm dodging bullets, I'm not going to be able to gain any perspective from a macro level. Lo and behold, when I actually forced myself to establish policies for primarily outsourced companies who are handling fulfillment, customer service, when I forced myself to establish policies that allowed me to go a week without checking email, it actually worked. And that's when I just kept on extending the trip and decided that for the next foreseeable future, with no end date in mind, I would live without 15-minute Outlook increments, which is how everything...
Oh, that's tough.
Yeah. And it worked really well. So that's I would say, that was the first milestone, the email. And I think that's a very good test, in fact, of how sustainable your business is without you, if you're the decision maker or one of the chief executives or principals. Can you go away for 2 weeks? Is not enough. Because 2 weeks, you can fake it for 2 weeks. You can let the fire smolder for 2 weeks and then come back and have them all flare up. But if you go away for 4 weeks, 8 weeks, you have to have good policies in place.
So now, do you think any business can do this, go away for, because I have to say, there's, you know, some people are a little bit skeptical.
Sure,
as you might imagine.
They should be skeptical.
And one of the comments I read with regard to your book was that mm-hmm. this one small business owner tried that, mm-hmm. and the company nearly fell apart.
Mm-hmm. Well, you could say, if you look at any diet, any behavioral change, you could always find someone who's failed. I don't think it's an indication. I think the question is what percentage of people fail who attempt it and follow it as a prescription. So I don't think that, just as a side note, as an author, for example, the biggest challenges that you face as an author with a book that has some degree of unexpected success, I mean, the 4-Hour Workweek was turned down by 26 out of 27 publishers, so you want to talk about skeptical. The challenge that you have is not the people who hate what you do. They're not the people who decide to snipe you and be really snarky. I got a really nice snarky review in the New York Times today. Pretty hysterical, actually. It comes out in the print version tomorrow. It's your fans who embrace the message but interpret it the wrong way. That's where things get really messy. But returning to the question, I don't think that anyone can do anything in the sense that I was in the UK, I was interviewed by the BBC, and they're like, well, what about the taxi driver and the bricklayer? I'm like, this isn't for them, necessarily, unless they're an entrepreneur and they run their own fleet. Okay, different story. I do think that it is highly practical, in fact, necessary for many entrepreneurs who feel trapped, or careerists who feel trapped in their current situation. It's particularly difficult for founders of companies who are trapped in a machine of their own making, or feel that way. Mm-hmm. It's like, well, it's paying the bills, my identity is invested in this, do I just shut it down? That's not a very appealing option. It's very, very challenging. And then there are the people who are in jobs where they've reached a point of tolerable mediocrity, mm-hmm. not in their own skill set. I should rephrase it and say tolerable discomfort. So it's not the best, but it's not the worst. It could be a lot worse. Mm-hmm. And that's how you end up in a job you dislike, or at least don't love, for 20, 30 years. That's really depressing. And so my job, I view in part, is to make that pain painful enough that it catalyzes some type of decision making. But I do think that it's highly practical. If you look at a competition, so I do a lot of angel investing, companies like Twitter, StumbleUpon, Evernote, and others. I'm also involved with a company called Shopify, and we ran a competition based on 4-hour work week principles of company creation, created more than 1,300 businesses in a 6-month period. And so it can be done, but will it work for everyone? No, of course not. Yeah, I wish it would, but sadly, that's not the case.
So then in the beginning of your book, The 4-Hour Work Week, you have the frequently asked questions for doubters. Mm-hmm. And you have the, will this work for everyone? Mm-hmm. No, but will it work for a lot of people who may not think it will work for? Yes. Mm-hmm. And so what are the common resistance that you get to this, for the book?
The common knee-jerk points of resistance are not that surprising. So, all right, you're 30-something, single male. I'm a mother of three. Convince me. I think it's easy for you to say. And in the beginning, it was very hard for me to counter that. I could certainly point to the principles and say, I didn't invent these principles. These have been around for a long time. This actually isn't that new, other than the context of high tech and the tools that we have. But if you look at Pareto's law, or the 80-20 principle, or automation and the principles of good automation and management, looking at people like Bennis and others, or Drucker, that's been around for decades. That's nothing new. It wasn't until I had enough of a data set, once the book had been out for a period of time, that I could come out with the revised edition, which has mothers of three. It has people who are fully employed but negotiate remote work agreements to live in Argentina for 3 months out of the year but still get paid full time. Or Chuck Holton, I think it was. He has at least three kids. I think he has five kids. Took them out of school, traveled around the world, ended up teaching two of them how to build their own companies, 12 and 14. Wow. His kids are now making, I think, $1,000 a month each with their own businesses while going to school full time. So
that's great.
There are outliers that I think prove how applicable. I need more caffeine. It can be, broadly speaking. The other points of resistance, I would say, relate to me. For whatever reason, I'm a very polarizing character.
So I notice like, that. When
yeah. So
people love you or hate you.
Yeah, so they'll say, oh, well, you went to Princeton. It's easy for you to say. And it's like, okay, we have to go through this again. But I don't think that on a principle basis, on a tactic basis, or on just a data set basis, looking at the case studies, I don't think that the early resistance is that justifiable. I think it's a fear of the unknown at the end of the day.
So some people get hung up in this title, the 4-hour work week.
Yes, yeah. They do.
And and your critics would suggest that, you know, saying that you only work 4 hours a week is maybe a question of semantics, that you probably mm-hmm. actually work much more than that, mm-hmm. but it's only the 4 hours of things that you don't want to do, which you mm-hmm. call work. Is that fair?
Sure. I would say a few things. The first is that the 4-hour work week, the title, was not the first title. So the first title is sold as drug dealing for fun and profit, which was a tongue-in-cheek reference to the sports nutrition company that I ran for many years, sold just a few years ago. Walmart didn't find that title as amusing as I did. So we had to come up with a new title, and I used Google AdWords to test about a dozen prospective titles and subtitles by bidding on search terms related to the book content, like world travel, language learning, 401k, et cetera. And the 4-Hour Workweek was the winner. 4-Hour Workweek is based on it is based on something, and that is, in 2005, I was spending between 2 and 4 hours a week managing that sports nutrition company while I was busy doing tango 6 to 8 hours a day in the case of Argentina. Okay. So that's not pulled from thin air. That did apply to a certain period in my life. But work is defined very specifically in my book, and this is not a dodge. I think it's very important. Just like success is very nebulous and causes a lot of pain because it is ill-defined. Similarly, work for me is something that you want to do less of or that's primarily financially driven. And in my case, I'm really busy. I mean, I love working on different projects, whether it's angel investing or I'm thinking about doing a screenplay or here doing this kind of stuff. But, you know, I'm not getting paid to be here. You could argue, like, well, you're selling books. Like, really? Have you looked at book economics? But this is fun for me. I enjoy it. And I always wanted to be a teacher. It just turned out that I became an accidental author, and that turned out to be a pretty good way to teach.
Interesting. So you're not the world's laziest man?
I mean, hopefully that's not on my tombstone. I wrote the 4-Hour Body to have to hopefully just be, I don't know, the world's most obsessive man, compulsive man, supposed to the laziest. We'll see if it works.
Okay, so you seem very much like a cat who always lands on his feet. You nearly failed kindergarten because you refused to learn the alphabet.
Oh, fed me soap. I left that out of the book.
No, she fed you soap. She made you eat soap. I read that.
For shame.
And you had lower than average SAT scores. But you made it into Princeton. You've been fired from numerous jobs.
That's true.
Numerous businesses have failed. But now you're a successful businessman and a number one New York Times bestselling author. Why do you think that is? What is it about you that makes you land on your feet?
I think I land on my head more than I land on my feet. Actually, two doctors who have fixed a lot of my problems can tell you that's the case. But why do I land on my feet? I'll be very specific. Why did the first book become successful? I'll answer it that way. And I think it became successful because it filled a void. When I went to the bookstore to try to fix some of these problems for myself, the problems that are common across the people who are profiled in the 4-Hour Workweek, my choices were I could read From the Gut by Jack Welch and learn how to become a Fortune 500 CEO and become Neutron Jack, or, which is not appealing, or respect the guy, don't want to be him, or I could read a book that was just very la-di-da, let me convince you money isn't important, and here's how to be frugal for the rest of your life, and that will make you enlightened. And I was like, I don't really want to do that either. So and I knew that none of my friends did either. And I wrote the 4-Hour Workweek. I threw away the first 4 chapters that I wrote. It was either very pompous, like Princetonian speak, which was horrible. And then I went all the way in the other direction, and it was like slapstick Three Stooges, which was ridiculous. So it took me a while to really become comfortable with my own voice and write the book for 2 of my close friends. One was an iBanker who hated his job but was addicted to the money and the lifestyle. And the value of your value in his peer group was decided by your income and your car. And then a friend of mine who was in exactly the same position that I was in, meaning he had a very financially successful startup, and he hated every minute of managing it. He was bored. He was over it, and he didn't know what to do. And I wrote it for those 2 groups, and I think there are millions of people who fall into at least those 2 psychological profiles somehow. They feel like they're trapped in that type of situation.
So I'd actually like to know, how did you get into Princeton with the SAT scores? I have a 10-year-old daughter, and I'm trying to figure this out in case she doesn't do well.
Quite honestly, I think it was because I had one Hail Mary approach to applying, and that was to be different as opposed to better. Everybody who goes, I mean, it was amazing. I remember my freshman year at Princeton, this tells you a lot about Princeton and similar institutions, but people were comparing SAT scores in the hallway freshman year, like, oh, you got 1,602? Yeah, me too. Oh, by the way, and I was just like, I'm going to opt out of this conversation. But getting a 1,600 on your SATs does not distinguish you at all. Just dime a dozen in the applications. But you know, spending a year abroad in Japan, talking, really emphasizing what made me different as opposed to better, which in fact in the application process does lead to making you a more attractive applicant, okay, was how I went about doing it. Great. And I think even at that point in time, I recognized the power of storytelling. And I used the essays. That's all I had. I used the essays.
So what do you consider your biggest success to date? If you had to pick one.
Biggest success to date. I would say there are two things. One is really truly getting to the point where I agree with Thoreau in so much as he who needs the least, let's see, let me get this right. He is wealthiest who needs the least. I believe that's Thoreau. But truly believing that and utilizing that in my life as a guiding principle, number one. Number two would be, this is the second thing that comes to mind, would be helping my dad lose 90 plus pounds of fat and gain 20 to 30 pounds of muscle as a 65-year-old. I mean, he went from annual checkup, this could be fatal, to I think you'll live forever and you're younger than you were last year.
That's great.
And I'm very fortunate to have a good family. I love my family, and I would say that's a big win. I'm very pleased with that.
Great. Well, you talk about outsourcing, and I tried to outsource some of my questions to Twitter and Quora, but I only got one, so this is a question for Quora. What's the worst,
makes it easy.
What's the worst mistake you've made in your life?
I would be tempted to say screwing up the relationship with Katie, but I'm not a seer. I can't predict if that would have worked out ultimately, but in business, I don't view my mistakes as failure. I think that a part of that is having been a competitive athlete for so long and having been exposed to competitive athletics for so long, wrestled for the majority of my sports career, then did kickboxing and so forth and so on, judo in Japan. And in most sports, if you want to get good, you have to be really bad. You have to get your ass handed to you for a long time before that happens. So you condition yourself to view failure as feedback. And for that reason, perhaps I've just brainwashed myself, but it's very hard for me to think of anything that I've done that has led me to this point as failure. More so, I view it as a lesson or as feedback. But if there were to be any mistakes I've made, I'd say they'd be interpersonal and not business related.
See, George W. Bush should have gotten that answer when people asked him about his mistakes. He might have had a better time. So what does a
trick
day...
Trick me once. Shame on you. Trick me twice. You can't trick me twice.
So you talk about this deal method, what you call the deal method for becoming part of the new rich. Mm-hmm. What is it? How does it work?
It's a process, it's a mnemonic for a process or a sequence that I've seen embodied in different case studies that starts with, and this, the beginning is define, so definition is D, E is elimination, A is automation, then L is liberation, which usually refers to mobility. But definition is the starting point, and this is true in athletics, it's true in business, it's true, and I work with some pretty big companies. You need to define your ideal outcome. You also need to define your worst case scenario, your worst case outcome. And that means quantifying, usually. What is your target monthly income? What is it that you're postponing? What is it you are working for in retirement? If you were to do it now and you could finance the big ticket items, A, B, and C, house, car, et cetera, what would be your monthly requirement, financially speaking? How far are you from that? How many customers, that X number, average revenue per user would you need? Things like this. So definition number one. elimination, I think, is very critical. And in American culture, it's very counterintuitive because I think we view addition as the way to fix problems, mm-hmm. which I think is also a problem in startups, feature creep and things of that type. It's usually the company with one feature that's a 10 out of 10, not the three features that are an 8 out of 10. It's usually the 10 out of 10 one feature that wins. So elimination, I think the perfection is when there is nothing more to take away.
So time management, that kind of stuff comes under
eliminating is meant identifying, as an example, the 20% of customers that consume 80 plus percent of your time, high maintenance customers, and eliminating those customers, firing those customers, is a practice that I think is very, 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 delivers immediately measurable results that can be very dramatic. Automation is taking the remaining activities that are required and identifying those that do not require, that do not rely on your core competency or your unique strength, mm-hmm. and then automating them somehow. That could be outsourcing them, or outsourcing is a very nuanced term that's usually thought of as negative. Delegating that to a third-party company in the U.S. or elsewhere. Automating the routine and the monotonous, the repetitive. And then liberation is actually filling the void once you decrease the amount of time you need to spend on income-generating activities. How do you fill that void? And quite honestly, I think the reason most people are workaholics, or many people are workaholics, is because they've let their non-work interest atrophy to the point where their choice is feeling productive by doing something that's not productive, like checking email on a Saturday, for example, or feeling bored. And I think that is a very scary place to be, and it took me a long time to realize I didn't have any real outside activities besides maybe going to the gym, because I'd been working so hard for so long instead of defining what my outcome was.
And so then you advocate these mini retirements then, instead of mm-hmm. waiting for that big payoff 20, 30, 40 years mm-hmm. down the line.
Yeah, the mini retirements are very helpful. Mini retirement meaning, let's just say, 2 to 6 months sabbatical, are very, very helpful because it forces you to improve your processes for work, unless you're going to just be taking that time off. You need to either find a replacement, identify what your process is, have somebody come in temporarily, or you need to automate things. So it'll help you improve your business and streamline that so it's more scalable. And it's very helpful to imagine how you would design your company if it were to have, let's say, 1,000 locations or 1,000 employees. Let's just say it doesn't already. And you need to have a scalable process. All right, so that's one benefit. The other benefit is that you very quickly get to identify what your most frequent self-talk is. So your fears come out really quickly, particularly if you take a mini retirement to a location where you do not speak the language and really put yourself in an uncomfortable environment. It's cheap therapy, in my opinion.
So what was your favorite mini retirement that you've taken?
I'd say probably Argentina. It's a blast. It was very inexpensive. I think that there are other places you can go that are still very inexpensive. Berlin was also great fun. Mm-hmm. And I actually, in a year, 18 months of traveling, I think it was 18 months of traveling abroad, I saved $32,000 compared to just sitting in my apartment in Mountain View. So it doesn't have to be expensive. You can actually save a lot of money.
And that savings comes from?
Came from putting my things in storage, eliminating rent.
Okay.
And that's pretty much about it. And just the expenses in California were higher than, let's say, in Berlin, or certainly in Argentina or Panama.
I think we can all sympathize with that here in San Francisco.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's switch gears. I want to make sure we get to your new book. Mm-hmm. What inspired you to write The 4-Hour Body?
So The 4-Hour Body was actually the book that I wanted to write all along. But I didn't have access. I didn't have the type of access that I hoped I would have after the 4-Hour Workweek came out. So I've been tracking my physical data since between ages 16 and 18, meaning workouts, food logs, very, very compulsive about it.
A little Howard Hughes there?
A little Howard Hughes, minus the bottles of urine outside my room.
That's a
actually,
relief.
No, I take that back. You know what? How are you going to get samples? So I had the data, and I had been able to spot very interesting patterns in the data that led to counterintuitive approaches to training and diet that worked really well for different goals. And a lot of that started as a competitive wrestler. I was an All-American in high school in wrestling, And I routinely cut from about 175 to 152 twice a week to wrestle, which is all dehydration, which is very dangerous. I don't recommend it. But to do that without killing yourself, you do have to understand how certain things function. You do have to understand electrolyte balance. You do have to understand rehydration. Pedialyte's better than Gatorade, by the way, side note. And when I had then, after the four-hour work week, access to some of the best doctors, some of the best scientists from NASA and elsewhere, coaches, professional athletes, I could really just take my pick of where I wanted to go and what I wanted to have tested. So if I wanted to go to Cape Town and meet with Dr. Timothy Noakes, who's a very famous ultramarathoner, but he's also been probably cited in 400 to 1,000 studies, to have muscle biopsies done there and have my muscle fibers analyzed at their myography lab, I could do that. Wouldn't have been possible before the four-hour work week.
Okay. So this book is not only about rapid fat loss, but the subtitle also says it's about incredible sex and becoming superhuman. I think we all like that, right? Someone on Twitter recently said that one chapter made the purchase of the book worth it all by itself. The title of that chapter is The 15-Minute Female Orgasm. What made you decide to include that chapter in this book?
purely wife recruiting purposes. No, I...
Has it worked?
No. So I was the 4-hour work week, not the 4-hour work week, 4-hour body initially was just going to, it was going to be titled Becoming Superhuman, and it was going to focus on fat loss and muscular gain, and that was it. Then I realized in looking at the muscular gain, when I was trying to replicate a number of experiments with different male subjects, if their HPTA, so if their hypothalamus pituitary testosterone axis was out of whack, they couldn't produce anabolic hormones properly, they couldn't gain muscle. So I started looking at testosterone, and that led to all sorts of interesting stuff. And I was showing an early version of the book to a few of my my female friends, and they're like, "What the hell is this? What is this, a boys' club? What about the girls?" And I was like, "All right, well, what questions do you want answered?" And they handed me a bunch, and they were all related to sex. So, okay, in the name of science, I will sacrifice. and that's how the 15-minute female orgasm came about.
So I have to warn you, I had it on my Kindle. I was looking at work, and it's pretty graphic, so not safe for work. You might want
to... Yeah. Well, I tried to have the photographs included. That was a non-starter. We're going to have to plastic wrap the book. You can't have the photos. All right. And so we did illustrations. What really was amusing about this was, and it was not planned this way, but it just so happens that the most graphic illustrations of female genitalia are right in the middle of the book. So if you're just randomly throw the book open, it's like boom, which has turned out, I think, to convert browsers to buyers pretty well.
So in the chapter on sexuality, you also noted that you've stopped carrying a cell phone in your pants pocket. Can you tell us why?
I can, and this is actually, I struggled with whether to include this or not, because the whole cell phones will kill you, and this, that, and the other thing, most people associate, as I did, with, like, your aunt Becky, who also likes crystals, and it's like, oh, please, I'm not going to put, like, tinfoil on my head to protect me from the aliens, I'm not going to do it. But I was interviewing a very famous strength coach named Charles Poliquin, and he had noted in one of his interviews that he associated low T values, testosterone, with athletes who carried their cell phones in their pockets. So I asked them, somewhat, and not in a condescending manner, but I didn't really believe it, and I said, so, okay, you've observed that A, B, and C, and he goes, observed? What are you talking about? He goes, look at the literature yourself. Okay, so he gave me a few pointers, and I did look at the literature, and when you separated out the studies that were directly or indirectly funded by industry, meaning manufacturers and carriers and so forth, there was a very compelling case that very limited cell phone exposure, and when I say cell phone, I mean cell phone, GSM, I think it was 900 megahertz cell phones, 1 hour could severely negatively affect sperm morphology, meaning shape, motility, meaning swimming direction, doesn't do you very much good if they're going the wrong way, count, etc. And that was 1 hour. And in California, something like 30... I'm sure that number is outdated already. At least 30% of males in California rely on their cell phones exclusively as phones. How long is that sitting in your pocket a day? 10 hours? 12 hours?
Wow.
And
fertility rates are going down, or testosterone.
Oh yeah. And I was able to do a few things among which was turning off the cell phone or keeping it out of my pocket. Also identified a selenium deficiency that I fixed, which can significantly affect
sperm. I think some people who haven't read the book maybe not know that you had your sperm tested, right? To make sure,
right,
to see what your testosterone levels were.
So I doubled my sperm count in 3 months. Okay. That is non-trivial. And
so are you trying to have a baby? Is that?
I just want superhuman sperm. You never know.
Well, you've also frozen what you call your swimmies, right?
I have frozen my swimmies. And the reason that I became interested in sperm count specifically was because I had a few brushes with mortality. I had a very bad motorcycle accident. I had a friend of mine die, sadly. And I realized, you know, maybe it's a good idea to start storing sperm while it's still somewhat healthy. It's not going to get better with age, certainly. Sure. And went in fully expecting to have... didn't even occur to me that there would be any issue. And the lab results came back, which they always do, because they're checking the sample. They were like, this is actually not a good sample. What do you mean it's not a good sample? Sperm count's not that great, buddy. Let's take a look. And I was just flabbergasted. And then over time, because tests are error prone. Most tests can have errors. So I never make a decision based on one test. I always repeat it. So I repeated, and over time, it just got lower. And this freaked me out, I think, with good cause. And that's why I became very interested in this and realized that even among healthy males in industrialized countries, I mean, sperm count's lowering something like 1% a year.
That's crazy.
And has been for 20 years. So I very strongly believe that of men, let's just say 30 to 35 right now, who aim to have kids in the next 5 years, I would say at least 20% are going to have difficulty conceiving. At least minimum, bare minimum. I think that's very conservative. So
that's scary.
It is scary. Side note for women, fertility related gluten, get rid of gluten, and also I would recommend that you consider increasing saturated fat intake. I've seen dozens of case studies, miscarriage, 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 eliminate gluten, add in saturated fat, pregnant, like, within 2 weeks. It's amazing.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
So then you talk about, you know, the minimum effective dose, I think it is. Mm-hmm. Can you tell me how that relates to exercise and some of your philosophies?
So there's the challenge with exercise and diet is there is a never-ending stream of misinformation to filter through. And the business model is more or less complicated to profit. So you can't publish a monthly magazine without having something new to talk about every month. And physiology hasn't changed all that much in the last 50 years, I would say. So the minimum effective dose was a principle that also guided the search within exercise, within diet, within supplementation, within drugs of various types, to find the precise dose that would produce the desired outcome. And anything above that dose was viewed as deleterious. You know, it would produce side effects. And this is certainly true with training as well. You have people who train 20, 30 hours a week for the Ironman. Is that going to compromise your immune system unless you have some freak of nature mutation? Sure, it absolutely will. Is that going to negatively affect your relationships? I would imagine so. So really trying to get precise about the dosing of exercise, viewing it as medicine. And what you realize is if someone says, do 3 sets of 12, it's like, well, why 3 sets of 12? Why not 3 sets of 10? Why not 5 sets of 6? And there's very little justification for it. But there are some corners of the exercise world where people are looking at, for example, time under tension. So you use this load, let's say 15 pounds in a lateral raise, and between 80 and 120 seconds of tension will produce hypertrophy, meaning muscle growth of the following type. And you can get very, very precise with it. And as a result, the outcomes are very predictable for most people. And that's how you reach your genetic potential in 6 months or less with a lot of these things, is by being very, very specific and tracking your responses to things.
So the book is very, you know, very minimalist in some of your recommendations. Mm-hmm. You know, that the slow carb diet is all of just a few pages, the actual diet part of it. I'm sure there are some naysayers who say, wait a minute, it's got to be more complicated than this.
So the naysayers typically fail to realize is that the how-to isn't that important. And what I mean by that is the perfect program does you no good if you don't follow it or if you abandon the method after 3 weeks. Mm-hmm. Simple works. And I, first and foremost, before even looking at the specific methods, met with people like BJ Fogg of the Persuasion Lab at Stanford to discuss behavioral change. Lo and behold, for example, if you take people over 50 and try to teach them to quit smoking using texting, fail, because it's two new behaviors.
Oh, interesting.
And I think most complicated or sophisticated, that's how they would be labeled, exercise programs ask you to change too much too quickly, and it doesn't work. So taking the path of least resistance and using a simple tool, like, as an example, your iPhone to take photographs of your food before you eat it, which has been called the flash diet, is very effective for changing behavior.
So even that's not to put on Yelp, that's to actually do something different?
You could put it on Yelp, but simply taking a photograph of your food is a pattern interrupt that makes you aware of what you're about to eat, and it makes you judge the food you're about to eat. So even if I don't give someone a special diet, let's just say this, we took 100 people, and we had two groups. We had a group that was assigned, let's say, the zone diet, strict zone diet. Here's a food scale. You're going to weigh your food. All right. And the other half, here's an iPhone. All you're going to do is take a photograph of your food. I'm not even going to give you a diet. I would bet, if the goal is fat loss, on the group with the iPhones.
Interesting.
From a compliance standpoint, absolutely.
So even if I eat a bag of chips, I'm supposed to take a picture of it before mm-hmm.
You'll be less likely. You will. I'm not going to say you'll stop eating chips, but you'll be less likely to eat those chips.
Great. So you treated yourself like a human guinea pig while researching this book. What were some of the more extreme experiments you did?
I'm not going to point at anybody here. well, for example, I tried to reverse all of my injuries I've accumulated in 4 weeks. Didn't quite work out as planned.
Wow.
So if I had no budgetary restrictions and I had access to the best people in the world, let's just say football player tears his Achilles tendon 8 weeks before the Super Bowl, who does he go to see? That's the guy I want to find.
Okay.
Or the woman I want to find in some cases. So I had some issues with my back, and I flew stem cell growth factors in from Israel, used IGF-1, insulin-like growth factor 1. Let's see here. Bone morphogenic protein, which I don't recommend necessarily. Also did PRP, which is very, very interesting, where you remove your own blood. So it's just like a normal blood draw. They put it into a centrifuge, and they spin it to remove, or I should say separate out the plasma that contains growth factors, and then you re-inject that locally into their site of injury. And a lot of it worked spectacularly well, but one injection was botched in my elbow, and I ended up getting a MRSA staph infection, and then needed emergency surgery and had to have intravenous antibiotics. That was not so awesome.
Doesn't sound like it. Yeah. We're going to be taking your questions soon, so if you want to start lining up at the mic, we'll be able to do that. So,
just as a side note, I make myself the guinea pig with that extreme stuff so other people don't have to test it. So then it gets filtered down to what's effective and safe. And then that's tested on men and women of different ages. And then if it still is replicable, then it goes in the book. But I wanted to include a few cautionary tales so people don't get stab happy.
Okay. So you don't recommend, this is not something to
going
do at
home.
Going down
to 6th Ave and
yeah.
Getting PRP done on the corner? No.
Yeah, good, okay. So you've written that you've had trouble with insomnia, which I think probably a few people can relate to here. Can you tell us how you've engineered the perfect night's sleep?
The challenge with sleep is that it's very difficult, has been very difficult to determine what you're actually doing when you're asleep or when you fall asleep. Mm-hmm. You can certainly determine when you get into bed, but between then and when you wake up, it's very hard to know what's happening. But there are new tools available, like the Zio, which is basically an EEG, where you can identify when you go into REM sleep, percentage of REM sleep, things of that type.
That's a really cool.
It's a really cool device.
Awesome, yeah.
You can also, I mean, I looked a bit like RoboCop, but I would have continuous glucose monitor implanted in my side and all these different gizmos and gadgets to track it all. And I realized some very interesting things. Number one, that light cues in the morning for me, which is like 11, using something like a Philips Go Light reduced my time to sleep at night from well over an hour to less than 10 minutes, as an example. Having 2 tablespoons of raw almond butter before I went to bed fixed most of my, oh my God, I feel like shit mornings, because it wasn't, those mornings weren't necessarily an indication of insufficient sleep, but often low blood sugar, among other things. There were quite a few, but those are two that are relatively easy to use.
So this year we will carry on the Inforum tradition of 2010 by asking all of our speakers the following question. Tim, what is your 60-second idea to change the world?
60-second idea to change the world is to make as many people literate as possible so that they can become independent problem solvers, so they can self-educate. I think that's the starting point. So I do a fair amount of work with Room to Read right here. Donors Choose in New York as well. I'm on their advisory board. I'd say that's it. Helping as many people who are currently dependent on some form of, in some cases, misdirected education, let's just call it, whether that's something from a very militant religious dogma or otherwise, giving those people the tools so they can learn on their own.
Great.
I think is very important. That's my answer.
As a reminder to our audience, this program is presented by the Commonwealth Club's Inforum Division, and tonight we've hosted an evening in conversation with Tim Ferriss. I'm Rachael King for Bloomberg Businessweek, and now let's go to the audience for questions.
Hi, my name is Greg, and thank you for this awesome presentation. My question is, can you go into a bit more detail about the cell phone studies that you
the cell phone, so I won't go into the specific studies. If you go to 4hourbody, just all spelled out, .com/endnotes, mm-hmm. then I do have the studies that are relevant to that particular chapter. But what I would say is if you go to, a faster way to do it would just be to search PubMed and go to PubMed and just search cell phone or cellular phone, mobile phone, sperm, something along those lines.
What was the was there any relationship between testosterone level and cell phone use, or just?
I ended up looking more closely at sperm production in that particular case than testosterone. It wouldn't surprise me at all, since testosterone is dependent in most cases. Your adrenal glands have some say in things, but the Leydig cells in the testes, it wouldn't surprise me if it lowered it. But I was looking mostly at spermatogenesis and cell phones.
And then last question is kind of quick. Just now you mentioned almond butter. I have your 4-hour body book, but I've been sort of working through chapters that...
It's a big one.
Yeah. like you recommended, through mm-hmm. just the ones that are relevant to you. And the almond butter is interesting. Does it matter if it's almond butter? Can it be peanut butter?
So this is a common question. So almond, if you were to look at it, let's say strict paleo diet, paleolithic diet, I have my issues with a lot of the strict anything diets, but they would say no. They would say peanuts are off limits. The reason I encourage people to stay away from peanut butter is because, and for whatever reason, especially women, have a lot of trouble with portion control when it comes to peanut butter. So with like physique competitors, I know some guys who are very high-level physique trainers for bodybuilding competitions, things like that. They'll say, okay, you can have one tablespoon. And I kid you not, they're like, wait a second, that's not a tablespoon. And it's like their female trainee with like the half the jar on the tablespoon balancing. So I usually recommend almonds or almond butter, but if you have the portion control, then I would personally say peanut butter is fine.
Great. Tim will be around at the reception.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
Next question, please.
Hi, Tim. I'm a great fan of your book, 4-Hour Workweek. I'm a software programmer, and I got two questions real quick. First one, following up on the cell phone one, so where do you suggest, so, you know, it's kind of scary, so where should you put the cell? Can we put it in the top, like, shirt pocket, or... Is that okay? Or?
So in my case, I did two things. So the first was I bought an in-case band intended for iPhones. I have a brick of a dumb phone, so it's slightly awkward to get in there. But I carried it on my arm or my leg, which looks ridiculous. I then ended up simply turning it off, putting it in a backpack, or turning it off. And what I realized is if it takes me 20 minutes to walk somewhere and then I can turn it back on and put it on the table, I've had no disasters, no real emergencies come out of that. Like, it can wait 20 minutes in most cases. So that's my current approach, is I'll either have it off in my pocket or preferably in a backpack of some type, and then I'll t- take it out and turn it back on when I get to whatever my destination is.
Right. I also skimmed over the four-hour body, and I was wondering, so how many hours of, because I've heard sleep is overrated, and your book says, you know, how much hours, but how many hours do you think, like, you know, is enough for if you're working like 10 hours a day, you know, coding, you know, you come home and, you know.
Yeah, it's very individual. So in my particular case, it also depends on how you're sleeping. So monophasic sleep, which most people follow, is one block of sleep. I like to sleep 9, 9.5 hours if I'm doing monophasic. And I think that if you feel like you have to sleep 2 hours a day to get things done, you should read the 4-hour work week first for the time management stuff. And I'm not saying that's you. But can you get a lot done using polyphasic sleep? Absolutely. Matt Mullenweg, who is one of the lead developers of the WordPress platform, had his most productive year of coding when he was following polyphasic sleep. And polyphasic sleep entails breaking your sleep up into multiple sessions throughout the day. And you can work down to 2, 2.5 hours on what's called the Uberman schedule. Now, God save you if you miss one of those naps. You're going to be worthless for 2 or 3 days. But if you can actually stay on that schedule, which is the epitome of being antisocial, but if you can actually stay on that schedule, you can get a lot done. But I personally sleep 9, 9.5 hours. But it's very individual. If you look at Dean Karnazes, he's a bit of a mutant for many things. He ran 50 marathons in 50 days. He's that guy. Lives right here and above the Golden Gate. But he gets 4, 4.5 hours a night, and it would be odd for him to get more.
I'm going to have to move on to the next question. Okay. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Becky, but not your creepy Aunt Becky who wears weird alien ears. I was curious, what's next? It sounds like you really got what you were looking for with this book. What's your next project?
My next project will be very different. It may very well not be a book. I'm actually quite interested in probably trying screenplay. I don't know if I'll be any good at it, but I would like to exercise a different part of my brain. The 300 plus citation books are taking a lot out of me. So I'll probably try a screenplay, I think.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Great. Next question.
Hey, Tim. Brian here. So as mentioned in the presentation, you've done tons of experiments leading up to the 4-hour body, and some of them are quite different. You've done ultra running, increasing your bench press, losing fat, and some of the training regimens and diet required for them are quite different. Mm-hmm. So I'm wondering what your typical regimen looks like for eating and working out, or if you're constantly just picking a new extreme goal and striving for that.
It's actually not far off, but right now, my maintenance approach is slow-carb diet, has been for 7 years, and the training regimen is usually, I would say, kettlebell swings, high-rep kettlebell swings, once or twice a week, a power training session along the lines of a West Side-style maximum effort day. All that means is sets of 1 to 3. With long rest periods, 5-minute rest periods in between, usually for the deadlift. Bench press is fun as an exercise, but I think from a functional standpoint, deadlift is much cooler and useful. And then I do walks in the morning 3 times a week, 15 minutes as fast as possible. That's from Barry Ross, who trains world-class sprinters. And this isn't really for exercise purposes, it's more for recreation, but one long hike on Sundays. That would be my ideal.
Great. And when can we expect an update on how your ultra running went?
Yeah. It's coming. Okay. I realize that the best way to ensure that I get that done is to have the entire world watching. So I'll be doing that. I'll be doing that very publicly. Yeah.
Great. Next question.
Hey, Tim. Similar question as the lady. What is one experience that you are still hungry for? Something you haven't had the chance to cross off?
I want to play with orangutans. I want to tickle orangutans and have them run over and leg tackle me. And I've seen videos of this happening to one of my friends, and it looks amazing. So I would like to go to Indonesia and play with orangutans and learn some Indonesian.
Also, real quick, red 4-hour body, I loved it. Can I challenge you to a push-up contest?
I will default and give you the win. I can see your pecs growling at me.
Next question.
So, about the cell phone in the pocket. No, I'm just kidding. Tim, my name's Anthony, and I really enjoyed your 4-hour work week. And one of the things that I personally admire is just anyone who has passion for whatever it is. And so, you know, I noted how, for example, you had your company and your muse on the side, and then you had your passions for example, tango, mm-hmm. that you did not remuneratively just because you loved it. And one of the biggest challenges that I have, and perhaps other audience members have, is that I have my job where I make a living, and then I have all these other hobbies and passions and pastimes, but they're not lucrative pastimes. There's a complete disconnect. Mm-hmm. And I was, you know, I don't know if they can ever be converted and monetized. What do you recommend for that? Do you recommend just basically living two different lives, one to earn a living with the four-hour work week and one to pursue passions? Is there any way that you can connect them to do something for a living that is your passion?
So there are ways to connect them, but I find that if you do something as a passion and then it, as a side effect, ends up producing income, that can work well. But when you set out to make one of your passions your income generator, that it's a fantastic way to destroy those as your passions. So if you enjoy surfing, I've seen many of examples of people trying both approaches. And if you enjoy surfing on Saturdays because it allows you to decompress and it's the highlight of your week, how you view surfing will change quite a lot if you're waking up at 6 in the morning, Monday to Friday, to teach it to people. And for that reason, I usually suggest keeping them separate, usually. But if, let's say in my case, I did this book, The 4-Hour Workweek, no one expected it to go anywhere, print run of, I think, 12,000 copies, and boom, it turns into this unexpected success, which I'm very grateful for, and it starts to generate royalty income, and now it's generating income. The driver wasn't the income, and I don't have resentment towards it for that reason. But for most people, I recommend, unless that type of situation presents itself, to keep them separate.
That's solid.
I'm sorry, we have just one
also,
more
I just
question.
Also, I just want to say I'm a big fan, but my brother is an industrial-sized fan. Your book transformed him, and he bought and sent me and about 10 of his friends and relatives a copy, and he asked me to deliver a letter praising
him. Oh, yeah, I'd love to read it. Sure.
Great. Next question.
Thanks.
Hi, Tim. I'm Anna Vidal.
I know you.
My question is about empowerment. Was there a point in your life when you realized that you could do whatever you wanted in life? You could be whoever you wanted to be.
I believe that really early on. My parents did a good job of exposing me to a lot of environments so I could find things I was passionate about, whether it was marine biology or illustration or what have you. And then I graduated, still believed it for about a year, and then just succumbed to the world. I didn't find the office space that amusing when I saw it in college. And then you see it after a few years in the real world, and you're like, oh, my God. Yeah. So I was just dying a slow death for a long time, did not believe that. And I think the serendipity of the book has reaffirmed that for me. Mm-hmm. But you need to progressively condition yourself to be comfortable with the unknown and discomfort, I think, for those possibilities to present themselves. I think a big part of doing what you want is having a very clear picture of your unique strengths and what you're bad at, and trying to multiply and leverage your strengths as opposed to fix all your weaknesses.
Thank you. Next question.
Hi, Tim. I'm Sunil Patru. And a few years ago, a friend of mine actually gave me the book 4-Hour Workweek, and I read it a few times to sink in some ideas. And at the beginning of this year, I actually quit my job. And while I was traveling, I started a company called Easy Sign Mobile, which has an iPhone app which lets people sign documents from their iPhone by no printing, no faxing, no scanning. So it's just a word of advice to the people over here that it's a great book, but you just have to pick up the right ideas that apply to your strengths and your phase of your life. So thanks for coming up such a great book a few years ago. If not for anything else, I'm definitely going to read The 4-Hour Body for the specific chapter, 15-Minute Female Orgasm, definitely. And finally, my last question is, what are the biggest fears you have which you think you are not going to face right now?
Biggest fear?
You know, that you'll die alone, that, you know, there's got to be a lot of them, right?
Talk a great game and die alone in a hotel room like Ayn Rand.
George W. Bush, I don't have any fears.
No, I would say dying prematurely. I mean, dying before I'm able to do, to have the greatest impact that I can have in whatever capacity would be one, just because I've seen it happen to so many people close to me in the last few years. It's really eye-opening. Not sharing, not neglecting to focus as much on appreciation as achievement, I think, is somewhat of an American pastime. So really focusing on gratitude so that I don't end up fixating on acquisition would be a fear of mine. If I backslid to my condition in early 2004, that would be a fear.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Okay. One more question.
Hi, Tim. My name is Christina, and I experienced actually that investment banking world after graduating from Harvard with an MBA. So I started a company, a website called Self Chi that helps people find self-improvement events that are along the lines of lifestyle design or health and wellness and so forth. My question is, I know that you take a lot of interest in companies and startups. What type of startups are you interested in advising at this moment, and how would one get in touch with you? What's the best way?
So the startups that I advise, I'm going to get all Buddhist on you. So the startups that I advise usually come to me through a friend or a referral, simply because I want someone's reputation to be on the line if they're making a recommendation to invest my time. A good way that a effective vehicle for reaching me would be AngelList. So it's angel.co. Okay. And that's a very good way to get introductions to very good angel investors, VCs, advisors. The companies that I advise generally have a very capital efficient business model. The founders, I like the founders, and that's I have my checklist for founders. The idea will probably change, so the founders have to be able to pivot well. It's a great presentation by Mike Maples on the pivot, if anyone wants to watch that, it's outstanding. I also have to be able to sell the product or service, not only to the end users, but also to media. And if I can do that, that means the messaging and the product is clear, and I can probably help them.
Great. So, last question next, please.
Yeah, I'd rather talk to you about surfing, but I'm going to ask a question that's more relevant to everybody. When you're starting a company, you put a good emphasis on recruitment. And do you have any advice on how to recruit?
I do. There's an excerpt or maybe a chapter used at Harvard Business School, among other places, which doesn't mean it's good necessarily, but it's called Zero Defect Hiring. And it's very short. It's maybe 5 to 10 pages. And that's one of the best guides to recruiting and hiring that I've seen. It's very short, but Zero Defect Hiring, I would take a look at.
Are you surfing much these days?
Am I surfing much?
Yeah.
Not as much as I'd like.
Okay.
That may change next month.
Great. I have one last question, and that is, you know, when you get to the end of your life, hopefully a long way away, when you look back, what will it be that you will have wanted to do? What will have made it a success or, you know, worthwhile to you?
If I loved a lot and never stopped learning, I'd view that as a pretty good ride. I'd say those are the two.
Great. Well, let's give a big round of applause to Tim Ferriss for sharing his insights with us tonight. Now, this meeting of Inforum and the Commonwealth Club is adjourned. There you go.
Great job.
That was great. Thank you.